Look at this front row. These are European institutions. And you can see the only point at which the Europeans hold most of the records as we come through time is in the 19th century. Which is to say, the earliest collectors in Mexico were Europeans. By the 20th century, essentially North American institutions housed most or all of the specimen documentation of Mexican birds. Mexico had a natural history museum as far back as the 19th century. Its first Mexican bird collection burned in a ship in the Havana harbor of Cuba when it was on its way to the World Exposition at the end of the 19th century. And so they set out immediately to assemble another collection, and that was mostly lost. Some colleagues of mine rescued what was left of it in the 1960s. But really, Mexico had to start fresh as of about the middle 20th century. So the really interesting thing is you see early dominance by European institutions, middle dominance by North America, but notice that North American institutions presently have accumulated and are accumulating very few specimens, and that most of the new specimens are housed in Mexican institutions. Now here's the really interesting thing from my perspective. These are, sorry about the Spanish labels, but these are publications per year that treat Mexican birds. And so you can see back in the 1800s, there were very, very few publications. And by the time we get into the 21st century, we have hundreds of publications per year that treat Mexican birds. Here's the interesting part. I've scaled everything to essentially 100%. And the red curve is the percentage of those publications that have a Mexican author. And what you can see is that by the end of the 20th century, as Mexico took charge of its own bibliography and the information about its own specimens, by the early 21st century, Mexican authors come to dominate the literature about Mexican birds. That, to me, was really fascinating. Mexico as a country went several steps farther. The National Commission on the Use and Knowledge of Biodiversity, it's called CONABIO, is a nationwide, quite well-funded effort to assemble all biodiversity information about Mexico, not just birds. And they have many millions of records, all neatly assembled and very easily and effectively available to you if you're interested in Mexican biodiversity. So it's not just birds, it's the Mexican biota. So it really comes down to something that Francis Bacon said a long time ago, which is that knowledge is power, okay? And I'll translate that slightly. Knowledge in terms of primary research grade biodiversity data is academic power, okay? But I want you to think about that. Essentially, each of you comes from a country that has biodiversity, and each of you probably has interest in the intelligent, sustainable, and responsible use of that biodiversity, or interaction with that biodiversity. Well, a very big part of being able to achieve those goals effectively is via data, via accumulating that basic knowledge that allows effective decision making. So biodiversity informatics comes along. And this is where things get complicated. This is a figure from that paper that I will make available with this presentation. But essentially, we have a bunch of things that we want to understand. For example, the genotype, the phenotype. interactions among species, environments, how humans affect this system, how organisms interact, and how biodiversity is lost. And then we have a bunch of products that come out of all of those areas. Phylogenetic trees, for example, document are derived from the genotype and the phenotype, and phylogenetic trees take us to taxonomy. And similarly, when we understand all of this sector, we can understand geographic distributions, and we can forecast how distributions will change. And from understanding this environment, human influence on biodiversity loss, we can come to conservation management strategies. That's a lot of fields. It's a lot of very diverse areas of expertise. No single person could give you a course on all of this. This is why we need diverse groups of experts to take on this field. Here's a simpler view of the same thing, published by Veronica and Hill a few years ago, but essentially envisioning biodiversity databases, biodiversity data portals, and then all sorts of analysis facilities. The complexity is clear. Okay? No single person is going to be able to take on all of this. I mentioned to you early in this talk one thing about biodiversity and informatics in the field, which is how we decide on what are the big questions. Ideally, we would have ideas and concepts that would interact with data availability, that would interact with, that would interact with technology. And so sometimes you have a really good idea, but you can't approach that idea yet because of data availability. Maybe the data just don't exist, or maybe the technology just doesn't exist. Like sequencing DNA has only been around for about 20 years for biodiversity. One danger that the field of biodiversity informatics runs is that sometimes we fall in love with the data availability of the technology, and those start to push what are the ideas and concepts. And it really should be the other way around, that our ideas and concepts drive how we prioritize data for capture, cleaning, and publication, and also the technology. So think about that, essentially, which way is the tide flowing in this field? And part of that question is what we can call the alphabet soup of biodiversity informatics initiatives. And one of the things I want you guys to come out of this course with is a bit of perspective on what each of these does. We're not going to go through them individually, but I want you to be thinking about where these different initiatives stand in this broader panorama of this field. So, for example, we have the Convention on Biological Diversity. Okay, sounds great. It's a 100 or so nations that signed the international treaty. We have GIDA, which is another intergovernmental agreement. And then we have national efforts like SAMBI and CONABIO and INBIO. We have these kind of, We have what I'll call kind of meta projects like Encyclopedia of Life and Barcode of Life. We have private initiatives like CREA. They're the people who did all that work I showed you in Brazil. I want to just touch on the question of what you should be looking for. Okay, all of these, I could have put another 20 or 30 on this, and I guarantee you in the next 5 or 10 years, you're going to see even more alphabet soup, even more abbreviations for a new initiative, which is everything in biodiversity. And so I just want you to think a bit about it. I'm going to set out for you three requirements for an effective biodiversity informatics initiative. First of all, is that it should be managing primary data and not secondary data. Second of all, is that the data should be research grade rather than toys. And third of all, it should make a genuine improvement in our infrastructure rather than what I'll call smoke and mirrors. It's something that you use to create an illusion that it has no real substance. So let's talk about the first point, primary biodiversity data. Primary biodiversity plays a particular taxon in a particular place at a particular time with documentation. That's as generic a definition as I can give you. Secondary biodiversity data are somehow synthesized, summarized, interpreted. So I could offer you point occurrence data, dots on maps with appropriate documentation, or I could offer you a range map. One of those is primary, one of those is secondary. The advantage of the primary data is that they offer the information without any subjectivity, assumptions, interpretation, or information bias. That's a huge advantage, because then you can produce your own distributional map, if that's what you want, under assumptions that are known to you, and by procedures that are known to you. Research grade data. This is the second point. Well, data that are served are often, I'll call it dumbed down, which is to say they're smooth, simplified, organized, synthesized, summarized, made convenient for you, but not without loss, which is to say some assumption and subjectivity gets in there. You should insist that the Biodiversity Informatics Initiative provide direct access to research-grade primary data. Essentially, could you base a scientific publication on those data? Or could you write a report for the Ministry of the Environment for your country? That third point is about real infrastructure improvement, and that's pretty nebulous. So I just made a list of adjectives: effective, efficient, reliable, publishable, novel, inspiring, should retain roots in the primary research grade data, and perhaps most important, it has to be sustainable. It has to be something that's not just going to evaporate in a few years. So I'll give you an example initiative. I think I managed to remove any references to names. But this is funded by our National Science Foundation, has a very attractive website. It allows you, I typed in Aquatabo congensis, which is a very unique peafowl endemic to the Congo Basin. And I immediately got 5 data sources out, and it produced this very beautiful map. And there's some really interesting stuff in there. There are occurrence data, which I believe comes from GPIC. There is some polygon, which I didn't take the time to investigate. And there are 3 different range maps. And notice that one of those is quite small, and another is kind of medium size, and the third is large. And I also, just thinking about data cleaning, I also noticed that there's this one point way out here, which might just refer to Kinshasa. So there's a lot of information here, but I'm not sure that this passes my test of research grade data. Well, how did these 3 maps come to be? I'm not sure that this allows me to download the primary data. In fact, I tried and I couldn't. And as far as sustainability, I wish this initiative the best. But if I can't get to the primary research grade data, to me this comes back. So, back to my three points. As a practicing scientist, does the initiative, whatever the initiative is, does it work in terms of making the research more effective? So just to summarize biodiversity informatics for you, it is a new area of inquiry. There's a lot of activity, including this project. There's a lot of incentives as to why we should be active in this field. Some of the initiatives are what I would call smoke and mirrors. They're just illusion, they're just pretty pictures, but they're not real science infrastructure. And then others are indeed effective, fascinating, and inspiring. So I would encourage you, whenever you see the next combination of letters, the next big initiative, which I'm sure will happen in the next week or so, or month or so, or year or so, I would encourage you to ask these three questions and others, essentially asking whether this is real informatics infrastructure or just smoke and mirrors. Any questions about that?